threw away after two bites because we felt like it didn't taste right. It was all I had to eat for the day. And did it for 7 months. And it was tough. It was really tough being out there in the elements. And I knew the second that I got back on my feet, which was January of 2014, so this month marks 4 years since I got on my feet again. So I knew that as soon as I got back on my feet, that I wanted to go and do something to pay homage to where I just came from. And that homage was that single pot of spaghetti. I went right back and served those who were in the same conditions I was just in 6 months ago. Yes?
How did you get back up then?
We'll get there.
Sorry. Yeah, sorry.
That's okay. So I'm not what you would traditionally think of when you think of someone who used to be homeless. One, when you think of someone who used to be homeless, you think of a few things. You think of, or when you see them at a street corner, you see them holding a cardboard sign, you know, we perceive certain things. And some of those things that we perceive is, one, must be an alcoholic. Two, drug user. Three, mental challenges.
Or divorced.
Well, here's something that might surprise you. I don't do any drugs. I barely drink. I don't have any mental challenges that I'm aware of.
Yet.
Yet. Six voices in my head, though, tell me different. So you might ask then, how did you end up there? How did you get there? To be honest with you, paycheck to paycheck. I worked in a call center at the time, and at this call center, I had 7 employees who worked for me. I was a manager at the time. I started on the phones. I rose to a supervisor, rose to a manager, and then I was able to lead my own teams. I was the first one in the office, last one in the office. I worked Saturdays. I did everything society tells you to do. Pay your rent, pay your car insurance, pay your taxes, you know, live out a great life. I was doing that. And I walked into work one day, first one in the office, got in at 7 a.m., and when I walked in the office, the big boss was there. First one in the office, office doesn't open until 9. Most of my employees kind of come in around 9:15. Even though they're supposed to start at 9. And the big boss is there when I walked in. And as soon as I'm able to put my bags down at my seat at my desk, he goes, "Silo, I need to talk to you in my office." And I thought, okay, well, this means one of two things. This means I'm getting one hell of a kick-ass raise right now because my team is rocking and rolling. We're making him a lot of money. I'm in deep doo-doo. Something I have no idea what I did. So I get into his office. Before my butt hits the seat, he says, "I gotta let you go." I said, "What?" He says, "We gotta let you go." I said, "Why?" He says, "We can't afford you anymore." I was really only making about like $40,000-$45,000 a year. Here in Vegas is pretty decent, but everywhere else is crap money, especially if you live in New York or LA. And I said, "Well, that's an easy fix. I'll take, you know, slice my salary in half. I'll do whatever it takes. I'll take $30,000 a year. That's an easy fix. Let's do it." "Can't do that, Silo." "Why?" "Because we can't afford you." I said, "Okay, that's an easy fix too. Put me on the phones next to my sales reps. I'll make $10 an hour. I don't care. I'll do it." "Can't do that. Why?" "Because it'll confuse your sales reps. Because they will sit there the entire time not performing because they're wondering why you're sitting next to them on the phones with them." He said, "I'll tell you what though." He said, I'll tell you this. "You cannot work this week. You are officially done today. But if you come back Friday, I'll give you a nice severance check. A paycheck at the end of the week that would represent you working this week even though you didn't work." It's okay. I can take that. I can leave with that. By this time, I'm already 30 days behind my rent, 60 days behind my car payment. I said, "That's something. I can live on that for the next 30 days. I can do something with that." So I go home, call up my landlord, say, "Listen, this happened today. It's not my fault, but you promised me a check on Friday. I'll have something for rent on Friday." "Because you promise, you absolutely promise, yes." Went to work that Friday, got in around 11:30. As soon as I walk up into the building, a huge padlock on the front door. Apparently the company that couldn't afford me couldn't afford to pay their rent. They jumped up and skipped town. not only did I not get paid, but the other 100 employees that worked there didn't get paid either. So I go home. First thing I do is I call my landlord. Hey, I didn't get paid today, but let me tell you what happened. Do you have the rent? You don't understand. Do you have the rent? But it's not, do you have the rent, yes or no? No. Says you have till Monday to come up with the rent. If not, the constable will be there to kick you out. An entire weekend, I did everything that I could. Sold my couch, sold my TV. I literally sold everything I could to make up with the rent. Only came up with about $200 from selling everything. Monday morning came. At that time, I was living with my girlfriend of 4 years. We had just had my son, who was 6 months old. And rolled over, woke her up. I didn't have to go to the door, I knew what it was. I said, they're here, back wherever you can, let's go. walked in to the door, constable was there, said, you have 15 minutes, grab whatever you can, get out. My entire life was in this apartment, in this condo. 15 minutes to grab whatever I can was an insult. And he treated me like garbage. So I went back and I did whatever I could. I packed up. The first thing I did was I grabbed my son's bag. I threw everything in there, diapers, formula, bottles, everything. Just bag was stuffed. By the time I had enough time to grab something for myself, I literally had 2 minutes. I grabbed a duffel bag. I threw 2 t-shirts in there, 2 pair of jeans, and a pair of socks. And by the time I got the socks in my bag, the constable was already in my living room throwing my stuff over my balcony because I lived on the second floor. He said he had to go. So I exit. I go down to the car, start putting the stuff in the car that I packed for my son, for my girl at the time. And literally I sat down and I just started falling out of control. I couldn't believe that my life had come to this. I felt like an utter failure. Loser. She comes over to me and she sits down. She has my son in her arms. And she says, I understand this can be pretty painful for you. I understand how this can be hard. She said, understand that me and your son are going left. I suggest that you go right. I knew what she was saying. She was done. She was done with me. She was done being associated with failure. Someone who had failed her in every single way. So, I gave her the car keys and she left. That was the first day of being homeless. Nowhere to go, nothing to eat. I did the only thing I could do was I went back to the office I used to work for that had the padlock on it. And I slept in their underground garage for 2 days, trying to figure out what the hell's going on. What am I going to do next? Where's my life going? Why am I here? So, the ironic thing is that I ended up on Rainbow and 95. Now, if you're not from this area, Rainbow and 95, Rainbow is a pretty busy street. So, the 95 is a highway that kind of cuts through Vegas, one of our highways. And I'm homeless for about 2.5 weeks, and there's a 7-Eleven there. It's on Rainbow and 95 on that corner. And I don't smell too good. I'm still wearing the same clothes I've been wearing for 2.5 weeks. I got really good at like walking through parking lots and looking for loose change, or walking through down sidewalks and looking for change in the cracks of sidewalks. You know, the pennies that you usually drop and find that it's not worth picking up. So the pennies that I would count to try and find a bag of Doritos to eat for the day after I've collected enough pennies. So I would hang out at that 7-Eleven and I would just watch people get in and out of cars and I'd just wait for that sound, that ding 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 ding. Wait to see if they'll bend over and pick it up, right? And I would people watch. And the people that would come in, they'd get out of their cars and they'd go inside and they'd get whatever they came for and they'd get in their cars. And I would sit there and I would just imagine. I go, wow, they just drove up in a BMW. He must have a great life. Wow, he's driving a brand new Honda. Dressed sharp. Sure he has a pretty girlfriend. A nice house. I just do that all day long. One of the worst parts about being homeless isn't necessarily not knowing when you're going to eat next. It's not knowing or having an address to go home to at the end of the day. The worst part about being homeless is how other people treat you while you're homeless. When you're homeless, you're a ghost. No one says hi to you. No one knows your name. No one acknowledges you. And it's the little things that you notice while you're homeless. It's that person who's walking down the sidewalk in your direction and sees you sitting there, standing there at the intersection, waiting for the light to turn green so that you can cross, who sees you, crosses the road, and continues walking in the same direction the other side. Gosh, everybody has to pass you. It's being at the intersection with your cardboard sign and that car rolling up that once had the windows down. Once you get to the intersection, the light turns red, you see it on his face, goes, fuck, rolls his windows up, hops on his phone, turns the stereo, so he doesn't have to acknowledge that you're standing there. That's what hurts the most. So to answer your question, one day I was hanging out at the 7-Eleven, and this guy just showed up. He says, hey man, I come here all the time. I've been seeing you. You just stand next to this garbage can. And I approached him. I was like, who are you? Get away from me. Like, literally, because I've had no human contact for months. I couldn't believe he was talking to me. Leave me alone. This is usually what normal people go, oh, he's a crazy bum. Right? But it's just that you have zero human contact. Can you imagine going the next 6 months of your life? Zero human contact? Zero. And how you would be if someone walked up to you at the end of 6 months and says, hi. You'd be just, who are you? Leave me alone. Don't talk to me. And that's what I did. This guy, I can't tell you why. Persistent. Every day he'd show up at the same time, and I'm standing like, this guy again. Don't give a life. He'd show up and he's like, hey man, how's your day? Man, you're fucking homeless, what do you think? And he's like, well, I just want to, you know, do you need anything? Do you want water? Do you want a sandwich? I'm like, yeah, I can use some water and a sandwich, and then we just started to build a relationship. And he kept coming around every day and kept telling me, hey man, you're going to be something one day. Hey man, you're special. Hey man, you got something in you. I'm like, bro, don't feed me that nonsense. I'm a fucking loser. You see the way I'm dressed? I'm sure you can smell me. I haven't showered in 6 months. Don't tell me that stuff, bro. I'm not listening to you. You just kept coming down every day, same stuff. You're special, you're unique, you're different, you're gonna get out of this, you're better than this. Matter of fact, because of him, I did get out of there. And I named my book after him. Well, after that, it's called Better Than This. He kept telling me, you're better than this, you can do it, you can do this. One day he came up after we built the relationship and he said, hey man, I want to tell you something. I was about to go into business with a friend of mine. And, well, the partnership didn't work out. But I was a little proactive and I got this little office space. It's 10 by 12. It's not big. It's just a little office suite. Kind of place where the rent is so cheap that they entice you in with cheap rent and free utilities. But the office is really, really tiny. He says, I got to tell you something. I'll be honest with you. He said, I did not pay the rent on it last month because the partnership didn't work out. He says, I don't plan on paying the rent on it this month. And I'm sure everything that's in that office, they're just simply going to throw away anyway. And he goes like this. But I have the key. And if you want it, I'll give it to you. And I took it. I had no idea what that key was or what it was going to mean to me at that time. But I knew that key was an opportunity. It was success. It was security, it was comfort, it meant I had a roof over my head, it meant I had a door that I can lock and unlock at any time. It means when I fall asleep, I don't have to fall asleep with one eye open, hoping that no one would steal my shoes and socks while I sleep. It was everything, that key was everything. So I took it. Best thing about this little office, utilities were all included, and as soon as we walked in, the first time I walked into that office, it was really like, there's nothing in it. There's three tables here, like banquet size tables that you can fold and unfold, right? Just banquet white tables and a few chairs, folding chairs, nothing matched. It was just looked like someone's, like, I don't know, hobby office. But the best thing about it was one of these tables had a computer on it, a desktop computer. And it was one of those desktop computers that was so old, it was like from like 2000 or whatever. So if you like open up more than like two tabs, it would crash on you. It was like, I did not compute, right? But the best thing about it was that the utilities were included, which means I had light and internet. And to me, I didn't care how shitty that computer was. It was my connection to the world. And the first thing I did was I went online, I just started hustling. I went on Craigslist, I started doing odd jobs, moving rock, cleaning toilets, doing whatever I can, sell oranges by the street. I did it all. And I got bold enough to create a resume. Bold. Bold. 6 months, same clothes, smell like garbage, beard out to here, hair looks like a rat's nest. Bold, I mean bold. And I submitted that resume to probably over 200 jobs. And I literally went on 70 interviews, and I've heard 69 ways you can tell somebody no. Not right now, uh-uh. And that's if I was able to get through the front door. Because one of the things that happened on those first 40 interviews was as soon as I would enter the lobby and they saw me, the receptionist would come out from behind the table and go, "You can't come in here." "What do you mean, I'm here for the interview?" "Sure you are, you can't come in here. Leave before I call security." "I'm here for the interview." Yeah, okay, leave. That happened probably 40 times. I just kept going. So job number 70, I got lucky. I walked into the office. It was a tiny office, little call center again, tiny little office. As soon as I opened up their front door, no lobby, no receptionist. And I'm standing there, I'm in the center of their bullpen. Everybody's on the phones, the buzz is great, they're all on the phones and they're selling. It's kind of like, you know, those scenes that you see in like the Wall Street movies where they're like, "Buy, buy, buy, sell, sell, sell," and there's paper flying everywhere. And I was like, I love this place. And I see this guy in this office in the back, and he obviously the manager, because he's sitting by himself, he's not in all the chaos. And he kind of peeks over like this from the desk and peeks back and goes, "Peeks over." I'm just standing there like, you know? And he walks over to me. He goes, "Can I help you?" "Oh, yeah. I'm here for the 1 o'clock. He goes, "Your silo?" "That's me." Looks me up and down. "All right." And he walks me into his office. And he hires me. So, I can't tell you why he hired me. The only way that I can kind of grasp it was that it was a job that was like straight commission. So whether I performed or not, he wasn't really losing anything. Right, and but to me, all I needed was simply an opportunity. That's all I needed. So my work ethic kicked right in. I was the first one in the office, last one in the office. Eventually, because of not showering and the way I was dressed and looked, you know, they had to move employees away from me. But it was okay. And I was working Saturdays. First 30 days there in the office, I'm the number one sales rep in the office. First 60 days I was there, I was outbeating the senior reps that have been there for 4 years plus in sales. And I was just murdering it. And then all I did was I just saved every single paycheck, every single penny. I saved it. I ate that opportunity up like it was cake. And I just saved. And eventually I stopped walking to work because I can now afford a bus pass. Right? And then eventually I worked up to buying myself a bicycle and I rode a bike to work. And eventually I saved enough money. I bought a scooter, like those little motor scooters. Like that was me. Like, you know, the scooters you see on the street, you try to run them off the street because they're annoying. And, like that was me for like 6 months. Right? I was on those motor scooters. And it was the world to me. I thought I was like a ninja. I was like, yeah, let's do this. Right? And eventually saved up my money and bought a car and moved into a room for rent and then eventually got my own apartment and kind of just, you know, built my life all over again from there. And, you know, the first 6 months after I got back on my feet of January of 2014, after I had a little bit of food in the fridge and a little bit of comfort, I felt okay and I was back in society again. That's when I went and served my first pot spaghetti. And I've been serving ever since.
Amazing.
So it's just my way of paying homage. It's my way of, so the guy who stepped into my life, his name is Eric. Every day when I go out and serve, I'm looking for the next version of me.
How many total meals again?
97,000. I think we peaked 97,400 some odd after Thanksgiving of last year. Thanksgiving we did 3,796 meals in one day. So every time I go out and I have the opportunity to impact someone, I'm literally looking for the next me, the next version of me. Mm-hmm. Who is that person? You know, and for us as an organization, it's just my way of paying it forward. It's my way of just being it, right? And passing and becoming Eric to someone else. So with that in mind, you know, with that mindset, over the last 3 years, we were able to take 100 lives off the streets.
Wow.
So with the 100 lives that we've taken off the streets, with a 90% success rate, what that means is that they have housing. They have, a wife, boyfriend, girlfriend. They have two steady jobs. They have a car. They have income. They're back in society. They're paying taxes. Oh, thank you. And it's literally simply because, you guys heard the old saying, can't bullshit a bullshitter, right?
Yeah.
So when someone steps in front of me, and they're in our lines, and we're serving them, and keep this in mind, too. You know, we do our servings, and our servings that we do, I literally consider them as a net. Like, it's bait. Literally, to be honest with you, it's bait. Our servings are just bait to get all of those who are less fortunate at one place at one time so we can go through our line and find the next sidewalk. Now, the way that we create that bait is through food, clothing, hygiene, haircuts, love, hugs, you name it. That's just on the surface. That's the surface stuff. Like, to go six layers below that, it's now that you have a full stomach, now that you have a clean shirt on your back, now what can we do for you? Now what can you do? Because that's where the real work begins.
So remember what we shared about how do you effectively get people